This value education has to do with the basic concern of human existence. Basically, there are two major issues concerning human existence. One is what to do, the other is how to do. What to do means what as a human being he has to do and he doesn't have to do. This is one set of issues, set of concerns of human existence. The other is how to do what he wants to do or what he has to do. So the first one, what to do, is concerned with his purpose, his goal, his target, what he considers is valuable for him or what is valuable for him. And the second one, how to do, it concerns with how to ensure the fulfillment of the goal, the purpose, what he considers as valuable. So for human being, both are necessary, to know what to do and to know how to do it. So the first one, to know what to do, what is valuable for him, what is of value for him, is the domain of value education. The second one, how to do, is in the domain of technical education or education for skill development. So if you look at this, both of them are important for human being. It is important for him to know what is valuable for him, and it is also important for him to find out how he can ensure the fulfillment of what he considers valuable. So both value education and technical education are important. In fact, they are complementary to each other. And if you look at the priority of the two, you can find out that it is certainly the first priority is for value education, followed by technical education. So both are required. The value education is required and technical education is required. So it is important for human being to decide, to know, to find out what is valuable for him. And it is also important for him to find out how he can ensure the fulfillment of these values, this purpose, this course. So UPTU has realized the importance of the complementarity of the two and the priority of the two. Therefore, it has decided to introduce value education as a part of the essential course for all the students who are undergoing the professional education, be it technology, be it pharmacy, be it computer application. So now it has become a part of the essential audit course for all the professional colleges under UPTU. So all the students undergoing this professional training will do this course on human values and professional ethics. So that is what has been the need. It is certainly clear, if you look at it, that the technology is just a means to achieve in an efficient and effective manner what is considered valuable. So what is valuable is something which needs to be decided by each one of us. In absence of this, somebody else sets our goal or purpose and we are made to work for that goal or that purpose. So that every student becomes capable, competent to decide for himself what is valuable for human being, what is the goal, the purpose of human being, this value education has been introduced. So this is what has been the need of introducing this course on human values and professional ethics. So this was the first issue. Once it was decided to introduce, the second issue was that of deciding what is going to be the guideline. So briefly speaking, there are two basic guidelines for value education. One is, it has to be universal. Universal with respect to time, space, individual. And it is universal so that it is not dependent on any caste, any creed, or sex, or age. It is something which is universal, which is true for all space, all time, and all individual. So this was the first guideline. The second guideline was that it has to be naturally acceptable to human beings. it has to be natural for human being, and it has to be experientially verifiable in terms of his behavior and work. So these were the two major guidelines, and the further details were worked out. So this was the guideline for well education. One, to be universal. Second, to be naturally acceptable to human being and experientially verifiable in his behavior and work. The third issue then was the process. How do we go about delivering this well education? So it was felt that it cannot be in terms of sermons, it cannot be in terms of, you know, giving do's and don'ts. It has to be in terms of self-exploration. It has to be in terms of, you know, the possibility of every student investigating into himself, exploring into himself, and find out what is human, what is valuable for him, what is his purpose, what is his goal. And this is something which every one of us shall be able to verify, shall be able to investigate, shall be able to explore. So the basic process of well education has been set up as the process of self-exploration. And this self-exploration can be done on the basis of whether it is naturally acceptable to each one of us or not. And second, if I live according to this, does it lead to mutual fulfillment in my behavior in work and work? That is, does it lead to mutual happiness in my behavior with other human beings? And does it lead to mutual prosperity in my work with rest of the nature? So that was decided as the process of well education, rather than giving sermons or, you know, prescribing do's and don'ts. The fourth aspect about the content of well education, it was felt that any education which addresses to the issue of what to do, to deciding the purpose, the value of human being, it has to encompass all the dimensions of human existence, starting from realization, understanding, to thought, to behavior, to work. So all the four dimensions of human existence, namely realization, understanding, then thought, then behavior and work, has to be covered by this education or this course. And secondly, all the levels of human existence, starting from the self, the individual, to family, to society, to nature and the whole existence. So basically it was felt that the content of well education will encompass all the four dimensions of human existence, starting from realization, to thought, to behavior, to work, and all the levels from individual to family to society to nature and existence has to be encompassed in this course or in this education. So that was considered as the content of well education. So keeping these four things in mind, the need for well education, the guidelines for well education, the process for well education, and the content of well education, a syllabus was designed, drafted by a group of people who have been working on this for last 30-40 years, which have an extensive experience in technical field. Some of them we can name: Dr. R.R. Gaur from IIT Delhi, Dr. Rajesh Sangal, Director, IIIT Hyderabad, and G.P. Magaria from HBTI Kanpur. All these people were consulted and they were asked to draft a syllabus. So this syllabus was drafted, it was placed before the Board of Studies and then the Academic Council, and it was duly approved. A detailed syllabus containing 28 lectures and 14 practice sessions of 2 hours each were worked out in an extensive detailed manner, and finally it was approved and was made a part of the regular, you know, course from 2009 July session onward. As a preparation for implementation of this course, it was considered, it was felt that because it is going to be implemented in all the 500 and plus colleges in UPTU, it is an extensive work therefore, to provide enough space for the institute, for the teacher and for the students. It was felt that the students may be asked to do this course in one of the semesters during his period of degree. For example, if it is a B.Tech, then in 8 semesters he should be able to come, you know, clear this course or take this course and, you know, complete the course. So that out of the 550, as per their convenience, they can start the course, offer the course, you know, and the students, as per their convenience, can take this course. So a plan was drafted to implement it in all the colleges in a sequence manner. So as a prerequisite of this whole process, the teacher orientation program of a week was designed so that the teacher who are going to offer this course have a proper orientation about the syllabus, about the, you know, the course content and the process of teaching. So the 7-day workshop, the 1-week workshop were planned, the teacher orientation program were planned, and the first workshop was held from 21st to 27th May, because the course was to start next, in the coming July 2009. So teacher orientation program was designed, then the teacher manual was drafted, and for the students the textbook was also drafted. So now we have the teacher manual, the textbook for the students. By now 5 workshops have been conducted, the teacher orientation programs have been conducted, in which around 182 faculty members from different institutions affiliated to EPTU have attended the workshop. The response that was expected was of the order of 10% of the teachers. You know, we thought that, you know, the at least 10% of the teachers would respond. But out of these 182 teachers who have come for the workshop, almost 100% of them have responded in a very positive manner. Almost all of them have said that this is something which is necessary for them, for their family, and therefore they will work it out with themselves, with the family, and then they will also teach the students. So that has been the response of the teacher orientation programs. The video of the workshop has also been prepared and, you know, made available to the teacher. The practice sessions PPT have been designed and made available to the teacher so that they can conduct this practice session in an effective manner. The related materials, you know, which are important for this course, have also been made available to the extent possible so that teachers have the access to this reference material. As part of the implementation of the program, it has been quite effective. In last semester, that is July 2009 session, around 100 colleges have offered this course, little more than 100 colleges. 22,000 students have taken the course. The exams have been conducted, the results have just come out. The results have been very satisfactory. It's almost 90% in the end semester examination. The feedback from the teachers who have conducted this course is quite positive. It seems that there is a significant change in the behavior of the teacher himself, and there is also some visible change in the behavior and the attitude of the students, and it is quite noticeable. In fact, we have prepared an extensive, you know, kind of a video of around 40 teachers who have offered this course, and we have that feedback available with us. If you are interested, you can see through them. The response of the change in attitude and behavior of both the teacher and the students is quite significant. I am not getting into the details of that now, but that can be seen, you know, it's available as a video. In the process, the attitude of the administration of the university, the UPTU, has been quite forthcoming. They've almost made it, you know, starting from the vice chancellor to the registrar, you know, to the account officer. All of them have made it a point, you know, to implement it in a very effective manner. So all of them have been very emphatic and very positive about it, and they have done whatever is possible, you know, to implement this. And it is out of that that, you know, it has been possible for us to implement this, you know, in more than 100 colleges in the very first semester. As regards the attitude of the local administrations, you know, administrations of the institutes and colleges affiliated to UPTU, it's also been very warming. In 1 year time, in fact less than 1 year time, in almost 7-8 months, we have been able to conduct 5 teacher orientation program, and the institutes have been able to spare their teachers, you know, send them for 8 days, okay, for this program, despite the fact that some of the workshops have been conducted in the middle of the semester, where it is difficult to send the teacher. Particularly, we have made it a point that these teachers are not going to be only in, from humanities or management. They can be from any discipline. Right? Because to begin with, this is a matter of attitude. Right? So the teachers who already have an, you know, favorable attitude towards it will be, you know, able to grasp it faster and, you know, deliver it in an effective manner. So the teachers who are coming for these workshops, almost 50% of them belong to the discipline of engineering and technology. Remaining 50% belong to, you know, applied science or management or humanities. So they have been very kind of forthcoming to kind of get their teacher oriented and start the course. We have also planned some one-day workshops to support the teacher who are conducting this course, you know, in terms of getting their colleagues, you know, acquainted with it, and other, you know, teachers who are teaching this course in the same city. So we are organizing one-day workshops for different cities, and the response of that has been quite warm. In fact, we have made it a point that these local workshops will be organized by the respective institutions. Right? Support that UPTU is providing is sending the, you know, concerned expert, the resource person, to conduct the workshop. The rest of it is all managed by the institution locally. And we have found that this response of this local administration to organize this one-day workshop has been very warm, and they have taken it as a part of the responsibility, and they are doing it in a quite effective manner. In fact, the demand for the one-day workshop is more than what we have been able to really serve. So both the administration at the level of UPTU and administration at the level of local colleges and institutions, the response is quite warm, and it is because of this that we have been able to implement this in more than 100 colleges in the first semester, and we expect that another 100 colleges will start this in this coming semester.